There is actually some pretty interesting connections between arithmetic progressions and this thing known as a straight line. An arithmetic progression is of the form a plus d, a plus 2d, so on, and this straight line thing is something ax plus by plus c equal to 0. There's some connections between those two is what I claim. So let's actually take some equation. So we'll take 2x plus 3y equal to 5. So let's take an integral. We'll talk about all integral solutions today of this straight line. All integral means that x comma y which satisfy the equation both have to be integers. So we'll take 1 comma 1. So we know 1 comma 1 satisfies this. Now to generate the next solution, I'll do that pretty quick here. I think the next solution will be 4 comma minus 1. What would that give us? 2 4 are 8 minus 3 5. Yes, so this satisfied. Now can I generate the next one? So here's where the arithmetic progression comes in. Okay, I want to generate the next one. From going from 1 to 4, I added 3. So for the next solution, I'll just add 3 to this, so I'll get 7. Going to from 1 to minus 1, I did minus 2. I'll do minus 2 again. I get this. Let's check on this. So what do we get? 14 minus 9, which is 5. Pretty nice. Let's check another one. 4 to 7, we went 3 plus 3. 7 plus 3, we get 10. Minus 1 to minus 3, we went minus 2. Let's do minus 2 again. So 20 minus 15, 5. Works pretty neatly, right? So there's actually some deeper connections over here which we're going to explore now. So let's take a general equation. Ax plus by plus c equal to 0. Let's try to find out y from here. Okay, we're only considering equations that are in the completely reduced form. So to speak that there's nothing that can be taken common from all three and cancelled out, because if I take something common, there's zero on this side, so I can just divide it and it'll vanish. So there's nothing that I can take common from all three. So now like here, we needed a first integral solution. We'll assume we already have one integral solution to this thing, which is x1 comma y1. So we know y1 is equal to minus of c plus a times x1 by b. Now to generate the next solution, some x2 comma y2, which is an integer. Since this is an integer, I would have to do x1 plus some integer k to get a new integer x2. K can be positive or negative, because integer plus integer is integer. So I'll do x1 plus k here. So I get the new y2 as equal to minus c plus a times x1 plus k by b. We'll move this to a new page here. So we had, from the previous one, we had y1 equal to minus c plus ax1 by b, and we got y2 equal to minus c plus a times x1 plus k by b. So what we're basically now planning to do is finding what does k have to be so that y2 and x1 both are integers. We know that if k is an integer, x1 plus k is an integer. Done. Now what do we need for y2 to be an integer? What does k have to be like? So we'll assume y2 is already an integer and then see what k cannot be. So we'll expand this. how I'm going to expand this is I'm going to take this part away and a into k differently. So I'll do minus c plus ax1 by b. If I multiply this, this comes out, and also I get ak by b minus ak by b. This thing we just saw, this is y1. Yeah, so we can substitute this minus y1 minus ak by b. So we have y2 plus y1 is equal to minus ak by b. Now y1 is an integer, y2 is an integer, so this thing is an integer, this has to be an integer, right? So if this has to be an integer, b has to divide either of a or k. Now what I claim is b can't divide a, because if b could divide a, if I consider this thing and I open this up, if b divided a, this thing would be an integer. We know that y1 is an integer. If this is also an integer, this also has to be an integer. That would mean that b also has to divide c. Now we had ax plus by plus c equal to 0. If b divides both a and c, we could take b common, but initially we assumed that we can't take anything common, so b can't divide a. Since b can't divide a, b has to divide k. So k, what can k be like? It will be some b into some integer q. So what is b actually like? It's like minus b, b, 2b, 3b, 4b. And then what is x1 plus k like? It's like x1, x1 minus x1 plus b, x1 plus 2b, x1 plus 3b. And what does this look like, my friend? This is simply an arithmetic progression, isn't it? You've seen this. Similar thing we could do for the x's. X's. Okay, so x is minus c plus by a. From this equation, I just took all the other things to one side and kept x on one side, and we already have a solution. Plus b by 1 by a. Now if we would do y1 plus k and repeat all the steps we did here, we would have this k thing to be, in this case, if you would do y1 plus k for the next solution, you'd have a, 2a, 3a, so on. And y1 plus k would be like y1, y1 plus a, y1 plus 2a. And what is this like? This is also an arithmetic progression. So we're seeing that once we have an integral solution, all the next, all integral solutions have their x's moving in a different AP and the y's moving in a different AP. But the story doesn't end here, my friend. There's some interesting stuff here. Look at what the common difference is in the x's. It's b, right? And what was b? It's the coefficient of y. So the common difference of the x's in the AP is actually the coefficient of y, and the common difference in the APs of the y, a, is the coefficient of x. Pretty neat, right? We can actually see this in practice. Let's take an equation here. So we'll do 7x plus 3y equal to let's see, 13. So we can have one solution as 1, 2. So I want to find the next solution. So what I'll do is, basically the coefficient of y was going to form the AP of the x's. So the coefficient of y is 3. So I'll add 3 to 1, I get 4. And the coefficient of the x's was going to be the APs of the y, so I'll take 7, but this time I won't add it. And I want you to understand why. This thing, whole thing, is equal to 13, which means it's bounded by the number 13. If I were to keep increasing both x and y, this thing would actually keep increasing. So So at some point it would actually cross 13, and I don't want that. So if one of them increases and one of them decreases, that way I can keep it close to 13, right? So I'll actually subtract 7 in this case. So I'll do 2 minus 7, which is minus 5. So let's try this out. So we have 7 into 4, which is 28, and we have minus 15, which is obviously 13. Let's try again. So we had the AP of 3 here, so we'll do 7, and we had the AP of minus 7 here, we'll do minus 12. So 7 sevens are 49, and 3 into 12 is I think 36. And what does this case give us? This gives us 13 again. And now you're starting to see how these linear equations, all their integral solutions are in AP, and it kind of makes sense too. If you consider an equation, what we're basically saying is that if you take one step right and maybe some n steps above to get from one integer to the other, you have to do the same to get to the other integers. If you take smaller step, you won't get integer. If you get take larger step, you won't get integer, unless it's like a multiple, which makes quite some sense. But still, we need to think about how the common difference in the x's is the coefficient of y, and the common difference in the y's is the coefficient of x. That's the most interesting part in this thing, and there lies some connection which currently I don't know, but I implore you to figure out. So once I have a solution, I can just keep getting new solutions on and on and on in every question, every setting, whatever exam, just by considering the APs in the case. Or if I already have some points, it's very easy for me to generate new points in something like coordinate geometry or something else. This is quite useful.